Hi, everyone. Thanks for coming. I am Nora Khan. I'm Executive Director of Project X Foundation, which is, is publisher of Extra Contemporary Art Journal, which is based here in LA. We're a journal of arts criticism and experimental writing. We're turning 25 years old this year. And we have an exhibition space at the fair in addition to a sales table called Total Landscaping, which is a partnership between Active Cultures and Extra. And it started as an excuse to read PDFs outside and in gardens and groves, and became a reading group, and then became this flourishing partnership and space. So if you want to rest at some point during the fair, there's a little cool pocket with some lime trees and orange trees and grapefruit trees, and you can just go in there, and I don't think anything's for sale in this space, so maybe it could be a little oasis. So Total Landscaping roves sites around Los Angeles and outside, starting with the Franklin Canyon orange groves, and recently we went on a hike with No Canyon Hills, and the reading group is made up of a group of artists and ethnobotanists and researchers who come together to read texts in site-specific locations, which become cues into weird LA and its layered histories. And so the texts have ranged from the funders of the orange groves, who also founded GeoCities, to the public comments protesting the development of the Verdugo Mountains. So a series of theoretical texts, didactic texts. There's some seats up here if you want to take them. Poems, narrative, bureaucratic forms, all the words that allow for research of a place that may lack an archive or a clear set of documents. So Extra's managing editor, Kate Rahunde, who I'm not sure is here yet.
She's running late.
She's running late, okay. She introduced us to No Canyon Hills, which we're really grateful that this grew into this partnership and collaboration. And No Canyon Hills is represented today by Emma Kemp, Mateo Altman, who's somewhere in the audience, and Haley Hopkins, who works with the No Canyon Hills Coalition as a community researcher, activist, artist, and poet. And Haley's also been coordinating the PEIR initiative, People's Environmental Impact Report, which you'll hear a bit about today. And Emma is a writer and researcher working across disciplines and is also an assistant professor at OTIS, with an extensive history in publishing and community organizing. So we're really grateful to host a lot of the folks and collaborators who are part of No Canyon Hills in the space, in the exhibition L space. And NCH is a group with a mission to conserve the Verdugo Mountains, where California's native plants thrive, along with a massive ecosystem that supports a huge abundance of life and is under threat development. And in addition to taking our group on a guided hike and tour, we were really taken by the expanse and urgency and reach of their project. So again, we're grateful to the whole team for all the work that you did within the project space. There's a really stunning archive table in the space gathering the people's EIR, which we'll talk about. And between the orange and nectarine trees, you can make a phone call to the mountains while looking at photos by Rio Phoenix. Oops, I'm getting the whole name right. If you want to learn about the space, you can take a newsprint paper, or we could see you there after. So I just wanted to invite Emma and Haley to talk maybe for 7 or 8 minutes about No Canyon Hills and the efforts and project and the working ethos, and then we can jump into some questions.
Thank you.
Thank you, Nora. it's great to see everyone here. This is the first time I've sort of given the No Canyon Hills presentation in an arts context. It's quite interesting. So I feel like I've been presenting these slides really frequently over the last few months, but always in kind of political spaces, legislative spaces, donor spaces. So it's kind of cool to get to be here today and share it with all of you. And just to kick us off, we're gonna give a quick rundown of what No Canyon Hills is, what we do, and the project. So No Canyon Hills organized in order to help preserve over 300 acres of significant ecological habitat in LA's Verdugo Mountains, which are slated to be destroyed for a luxury gated McMansion development. And that development is called Canyon Hills. One of the interesting things about the development is that it's fully approved. It was proposed in 2003 and fully approved by LA City Council in 2005, based on an environmental impact report that we're going to talk a little bit about.
Yeah, we have some bones to pick with it.
And the project really means grading over 300 acres of this wildland habitat space. It means ripping out hundreds of coast live oak trees, paving over active blue line streams, riparian areas, willows, and literally flattening the mountain peaks, taking that dirt and then infilling the valley areas. It's a very destructive process in order to build large luxury mansion homes. The sort of average residential square footage for those lots are 16,000 square feet, with 276 lots. And just to give you a sense of where this is, just north of the 210 freeway in Sunland Tohunga at the Latuna Canyon exit. You see the map here. And one of the things that we've been really kind of doing is trying to understand the ecology of the site.
Yeah, can you guys hear me? So the Verdugo Mountains are a really, really interesting place. They're basically like an island for wildlife, plants, and animals, because you have the San Gabriel Mountains over here, and then you have the Santa Monicas, and the Verdugos used to be a lot bigger, but they're really small now because they have been developed a lot. So they're this really small bridge for wildlife connectivity, which we'll talk about, hence this beautiful mountain lion here. And for plant biodiversity, too. And so it's not just, like, you know, one mountain lion being able to cross back and forth, but it's also their gene pool, so they're not just breeding in a really specific group. But this is a really, really special place. California has a lot of transverse mountain ranges, and there aren't many in the world, so we have specific geology, and when a certain thing with tectonic plates happens, your mountains run east to west instead of north to south, and this is an example of that. And when that occurs, a lot of really unique flora and fauna can live there.
And as Haley mentioned, one of the kind of crucial components of our organizing is to underscore the way that this particular project site sits on a crucial wildlife connectivity corridor, which means it really supports the passage of large wildlife under the 210 freeway, so they can move between ranges on either side of the freeway. And if this development goes ahead, it will completely block that development. And you can see here a map that the Santa Monica Mountains Conservancy prepared for us, just sort of showing us how this project site, which is bounded in pink, kind of bifurcates the larger habitat area there in the Verdugo Mountains on the north side.
And block C at the bottom, that's Latuna Canyon, to help kind of make the map more legible.
So that wildlife are crossing where that yellow arrow comes in under the freeway, and that's how they're moving between ranges, and the development entrance will be there and will block that corridor.
Yeah, so we've been doing pretty extensive citizen science work there, which I think we'll talk about a little more, but this is a speed run of our survey. There's a lot on this slide, but basically, so these are some of, I mean, botany can get kind of like Pokemon Go-y, where you're like trying to find the special thing, but there's a lot of really amazing endangered, you know, federally listed things, but then also just keystone species, which maybe you can see everywhere, but they're really old, or there's just robust populations and they're supporting a lot of life. So down in this corner is a hollyleaf cherry tree that has to be like 300 years old. We did a trunk measurement, and I hike all the time and I see them maybe 10 to 15 feet tall. This is a monster. And then some other different oaks where, and this is a really interesting place where some of the plants we found, it's maybe the northernmost cap of their range or the furthest east that they're going. So it is significant for these plant communities. And there's a lot of different little ecotones within this one space. Then the Bigfoot picture in the middle is the mountain lion. That was from one of the neighbors that saw him there. That's a mountain lion, I promise. And then this really beautiful Humboldt lily is a rare plant. You have a Palmer's Mariposa lily. And the little bee that's actually in my hand in that photo, we'll talk about more, but that's a really endangered native bumblebee. So there's a lot going on here.
And we've been kind of collectively amassing this data into an INAP project, and we have over 1,700 observations, and more than 60% of them are research grade, meaning they've been verified by other experts on the platform. And so really, you know, just one of the kind of undertakings has been showing and evidencing the biodiversity on site, and doing that through different means, both data collection and surveying and citizen science, through imaging strategies, through photography, through arts context, through performances, through hikes, through events.
Yeah, we got a pretty full survey season in too, because we were out there from February until now, and for a lot of like botany people, they think that this is the end of surveying and there's not much to see, but we've started mothing and we're finding all these different night-dwelling creatures. So the site is like, it's just so dense and there's so much life there, even at the dead time of the year when a lot of plants are going dormant and things are kind of resting for the summer.
And, you know, from some of this citizen science work, we've been engaging with other groups and other nonprofits and conservancies, including the Santa Monica Mountains Conservancy, the Center for Biological Diversity, the Kulu Conservancy, Theodore Payne, California Native Plant Society. We've had a lot of buy-in from various organizations who have kind of signed on to support our efforts, and also in the sort of legislative space as well. Senator Portantino and Senator Carla Menjivar and others have kind of articulated their concerns of this project and been submitting them through city council avenues as well. So this project has been, it's been fascinating and interesting and multifaceted, and it started off really as a kind of awareness campaign and has grown into these kind of many modes of activity that I think span both the kind of arts context, activism context, advocacy, legislative, and all sorts. So really, our goal ultimately is to try to halt this development, to demand further subsequent environmental review before any kind of grading or destruction of the land goes ahead. To rematriate the land back to indigenous tribal groups in the area. And we're working with different land conservancies here to see if we can make that a reality, and to continue to kind of talk about and advocate for plant, animal, wildlife communities and relationships to the land. In a nutshell, yeah.
Thank you, Emma and Haley. So I have a few questions and then we'll open up to the group, but I think I wanted to start first with your, if you could speak to your general approach to the land, because in some of the texts that are in the field guide and some of the, I'll talk about this reader in a second, with the public comments and materials that you printed, and as you formed your approach and gathered your references and gathered all this incredible artistic and scientific research, you've noted that your ethos is pretty explicitly decolonial, and I know that's topic, fraught discussion, fraught approach, constantly evolving approach. I'd love to hear about how you collectively think about and draw on decolonial theories and approaches, and what does decolonial mean to you, and how you navigate the land, and then what have been some of the biggest challenges as you've tried to do so.
Yeah, there's a lot more people involved than just us too, so I want to highlight that, and some of them can definitely speak to this more, like the indigenous folks that we're working with. Our ultimate goal is to get this land back in their hands and under their stewardship and co-steward with them. So that's really important. I think when you learn about plants and animals and you really like deeply commune with them, it becomes very clear that like if you are going to do so in a very honest way, there's no way to do it colonially. And so I think in, you know, Western society and colonial society and these systems, like, we get very separated from nature, and there's this idea that it's nature and us. It's two different things. And indigenous people have always known that actually, like, we are nature. And in this case, we're nature defending itself. And so we try to remember that and bridge that separation that has been reinforced through dominant culture for a really long time. And so just remembering that everything is interconnected and that the health of even the smallest thing, the smallest little bumblebee at the, you know, bottom of this chain is a chain reaction, and that these things all need each other to live, and we rely on these things has been just really important, but it also is so obvious when you start looking at everything. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I think, yeah, I agree, and I think it's also something we talk about a lot is how language kind of operates in this space of sort of land advocacy and land use, and even the term, like this 300 acres is termed open space, and kind of what that means or what that suggests, and also what that obfuscates and hides and conceals. You know, one of the things we've always been really explicit about is that, you know, this land is unceded ancestral stolen territory, and just to proceed from that understanding, so that is always in the forefront of the kind of thinking and language generation that we're doing. And, you know, I come out of an institutional context as well, mm-hmm. teaching at OS, and there are broad discussions around, you know, the decolonization of pedagogy and other mm-hmm. kind of institutional social justice aligned kind of movements. But what does it mean when we speak about it in a land use context, in a land back context, when we're talking about 300 actual acres mm-hmm. of land? And so one of the things that No Canyon Hills is also very explicit about is that we want actual rematriation of this land as an outcome, like a tangible decolonial product, which would be to have this land returned in some way. And again, we can talk about this more, but that's also a really complicated proposition, and there's a lot to unpack there. But I always, you know, come back to that Franz Fanon phase. It's like phraseology is no substitute for just the reality mm-hmm. of doing it. And so we are working with the Tatavian Land Conservancy and the Tongatahara Pahava Conservancy, which are two tribal land conservancies in the area that would ideally have a co-stewardship plan. Mm.
So moving away from maybe the more academic interpretation of the decolonial gesture as like iterative small change that happens in language, which is also part of decolonial theory, but back to decolonization not being a metaphor.
Exactly.
It's
literally
yeah,
just
the real
plan.
Thing.
Yeah. Like actual
conservation
thing.
As direct action and practice.
Yes. But what challenges have you encountered in putting this forth?
I mean, we're humans, and to do this, you have to de-center humans. Like, you know, talking with people and opening this up to the community, we've done really amazing community visioning, and I mean, we'll get into it when we talk about this as well, but I think it's really hard for some people to see the value in a space when they can't find themselves in it. And, like, the ultimate goal for me personally, like, I actually don't want hiking trails built through here. I think it should just be a place for wildlife. And I think that that is decolonial when you can, like, take yourself out of it and still find value in a place. Mm-hmm. But that is really hard to do, and it does take some work. But to get there, it's just getting to really know a place. Like, plant blindness is real. I had to learn what all these things are, and then I was like, oh my gosh, this is a whole world. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I think another challenge has been understanding that even with the best of intentions, that we are still operating within a larger colonial and imperial structure, and yeah. that continues, that structure is continuing, and it's administered in the contemporary sense through various legislative apparatus and other kind of protocols that we increasingly are having to interact with in order to do this work. And mm-hmm. so we're constantly coming mm-hmm. up against these very kind of like practical blocks and mm-hmm. limitations that are in place because mm-hmm. of a colonial agenda mm-hmm. that has existed for centuries. And so it's like, how do we're constantly having to retool and try and shift and be nimble in those spaces. And that's one of the interesting, I think, like competencies of the arts in a way, is that we have some flexibility in how we kind of navigate those structures, but ultimately those structures still very much exist. And so that is has been a problem. And also just making sure that we're not burdening our Indigenous partners with the additional labor as we do this. That we want to make sure that we're kind of supporting and meeting both the present and kind of future goals of both of the tribal conservancies. So that's also like an ongoing discussion about what that means.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I want to get to the protocols that tax and fixed tax get you, which is in the second half of this, but I also love that phrase, competencies of the arts. I think that's another debate that we could have. And I think this leads to this early conversation that we had about the twin poles of research mm-hmm. approaches that you have, both artistic research and scientific research, where I think we talked about this, artistic research often looks like pursuing a hypothesis or a proposition in the absence of documents, in the absence of a material archive, and gathering and assembling like multimedia and multimodal materials, which I think No Canyon Hills really core part of your practice of how you learn about this space and how you learn about the land. And so you weave together methods of artistic research that help you make sense of the space, but then you also have, you know, drone mapping and 3D modeling and live feeds, which you can see upstairs, and these hybrid methods of tech and scientific driven methods of research. So how do you see artistic research and scientific research overlapping and forming each other as you've gotten to know these 300 acres?
Yeah, they overlap a lot. Like Emma mentioned, this idea of like artistic competency, which comes from, I think, Stephen Wright and many people before, but the word's a little weird because you're like, oh, well, are artists special and have a special competency that other people don't? It's like, no, but there is like, I think artists do practice like thinking outside the box and coming at something from many different angles. And I mean, I went to art school and then I actually sort of like had a crisis and broke up with art and then got really into plants, and it's like come full circle because I think that we operate very much from the place of like Alan Capra, like art as life, or like the unartist, where it's like you can just be doing something and like deeply grounding into something, and that really is art. Like, you don't have to have these layers of separation or like these kind of gestures abstracting something. It's like, what if you were just doing the thing? Yeah, I mean, all of the surveying, it has been really creative. Citizen science is really amazing. It is like performance art. You know, there are these constraints, right? Like you were talking about with the kind of colonial things that we're having to interface with. But you still can play within them and like get many people involved. And it definitely has been this really interesting mix of those things.
I guess my addition to that is that in the exhibition space here, we sort of have this archival kind of display, and it's very, it's a presentation of documents and both kind of historical documents pertaining to the Canyon Hills development, and some of them are contained in here, these public comments from 20 years ago, which are pretty exciting to read. If anyone wants to dip into those, they're upstairs. And then the generation of new kind of material artifacts and outcomes from discussions and performances, and then collaborations with various disciplines. Like, it's truly this interdisciplinary space right now where landscape architects and scientists from various labs at different universities and artists and designers from different spaces are joining in to kind of participate and share their knowledges. But I think something that has been, I don't know, something that's been interesting for me to consider is in terms of like research-based practice and what it means to kind of deal with the conditions of display and exhibition. And mostly this project has not been about exhibiting or displaying or memorializing the project. Like, it's mostly been just direct action that unfolds in place and in time and on social media and through dialogues and meetings, like in the active public space. And so this is the first time that we've really paused to kind of present something as in an arts context. And so what does that do, and how does it add a moment of reflection to the work, but also how does it change how we see the work? And I think there's I have concerns and reservations about that, as much as it's also exciting to have the opportunity to do it. Mm.
So the public comments, one half or one third of the 550 pages is going around, and the first two thirds are over here. Maybe we could like pass them out over here, and you can see them in the space as well. But they're really rowdy, fantastic read. They're contradictory. They're overlapping. They're full of so many opinions that you know, I could see like jostling up against like the argument that you're putting forward, and because you have almost 400 letters in there that I try to read through as many as possible. So, but as you go through this like collective, what have been some of the most instructive public comments for your research, and how have you negotiated as a collective with the comments and feedback that have like contradicted your approach or challenged or critiqued it?
I think that something that has been really nice about No Canyon Hills has been this effort to just like involve as many voices as possible. Mm. We really want it to be a community effort and representative of many different voices. But definitely within that, I mean, there are some comments in here where I'm like, you like almost get it, but then you're going in a weird direction. But like maybe you could be on our team, because what if like instead of seeking perfection and purity, which isn't real, we focus on like a common ground that we could have, which is that you don't want this to be developed. Okay, let's start there, and then like let's figure out how we can kind of meet in the middle. Mm-hmm. I think that's been a big part of interfacing with so many people, where it's like it's easy to get very romantic about like organizing or community efforts where you're like, we're doing this thing, and it's like people are complicated and they have really different views. Mm-hmm. And some of the comments in here are like, I moved to Tujunga and it's rural and no one's here and I don't want all this traffic. And I'm like, okay, there's actually like a lot happening here and it's not all about you, but like, great. I think you could be on our team. So, just like meeting people where they're at, which even though it's hard sometimes.
It is, and it's even, I mean, we've had a lot of mainstream like media press, like interview, and sometimes, you know, the journalists, the reporters, they really want to try and get you, like, how do you personally feel about this? Like, what's your personal relationship to this land? And as much as, you know, we're always trying to shift it back to this broader, larger conversation around conservation, around land back, around rematriation, about land use in Los Angeles, about urban wildland interface zones, about you know, not building luxury development in very high fire hazard severity zones such as this, and all of these other issues that come up when we talk about land use and housing policy. But you know, people want your direct personal relationship to it, and so trying to kind of shift beyond that is part of the work of No Canyon Hills, is sort of shifting beyond how does this affect me specifically, and instead trying to kind of ground the conversation in something larger and more interconnected to the present moment and to the history of land use here. And so we held a community visioning event in Tujunga, and we had, you know, like 150 people showed up in Tujunga, and then there was like another 50 people on Zoom, and we opened a space really for various community members. And I mean, the thing about No Canyon Hills is that there are sort of like core folks that help with the organizing behind the scenes, but the No Canyon Hills community is really made up of just these various cohorts of people. And at this event, we didn't really know what to expect, because most of them, we don't know those people. And so all these people show up in place, and it's kind of like, with an arts crowd, you know, I can kind of guess, like, generally out, you know, kind of who's going to come to the art book fair, generally. But, a No Canyon Hills event in Tujunga, we have no idea. At a Universalist church. You know, we have no idea what that kind of conversation is going to be like, and what comes up when you bring lots of different people with very different relationships to the land together. But we were very set on making it a forum where everyone's voice could be included. We laid out note cards everywhere. We had everyone talk to the people beside them. And it became this kind of, in a way, it was this in person, in the present. And so these are all from 20 years ago, from the original EIR documents. And the visioning event was our updated take on that. And it was incredible.
It's a really different group, I mean, going back to kind of the interviews with more popular media, like KTLA and stuff, this term like NIMBY has been thrown around, and I think it helps them frame it in a more dramatic way or like in a easier to understand way. But we really laughed about that, because for anyone who doesn't know, NIMBY's not in my backyard. It's kind of some of these folks in this, the original Commons, or maybe a true Nimbys. But the visioning night was really fun because the community in Tahunga has really changed. Everyone involved has really changed. And also a lot of people whose this is not their backyard are a part of this cause. Mm-hmm. But I think that goes back to the decolonial question you had, where it's like conservation is not NIMBYism. That's a false equivalency being made. Mm-hmm. We're like not in Latuna Puma's backyard, but this isn't about me. This is about all these other creatures that live here that aren't able to give a public comment.
It's interesting that the public comments all generated, and I want to come back to the text, the original text that started this 20 years ago, the original environmental impact report. This is a brutally short, two-page web page, white text on a green background about Zone B, which we had in mind as we walked this like beautiful hike to do a site visit. And the people's EIR that you offer proffers the possibility of this very layered, dimensional, evolving, and living document, which is very, I find, thrilling to think about bureaucratic documents that evolve with time and climate change and with the people's experiences and needs. Incredible. I want to hear a little bit about how you see a living environmental impact report, and how is the idea of a living report shaped or molded your research and practice in this effort?
Yeah, the People's EIR is really exciting. So that name is borrowed from, and the framework we're working out of comes from two things. So there's People's City Council LA, which I'm sure some folks are familiar with, and the Black Lives Matter-led People's Budget LA, which were two projects that emerged around 2020 during, you know, COVID, housing crisis, all of the striking and protesting going on. And they locate themselves as emerging in the absence of city action to protect the most vulnerable. And so I really like that framework because it is sort of like for us, by us. And that's what the People's EIR is about. But originally the idea was like, well, let's just make our own EIR. Whoever the original botanist was, maybe they were the worst botanist or the best botanist. It kind of doesn't matter. I don't think they were that great. But this happened 20 years ago. So let's just do our own because the city's not doing it for us. But that actually was really narrow-minded because going back to like fitting into these colonial structures or quantifying these in a certain way, there's been so much going on at the site that it wouldn't really do it justice to make it just a scientific report that's two pages long. And so that's why this has become this really multimedia and extremely multiple authored approach, because there is so much that's been going on to get to know this place. And this is a really, I think any place is really complicated because you're looking at history. And even when I was thinking about it, I was like, oh, we should highlight the original fight that got us here. And at first I was just thinking 20 years ago, and then I was like, wait, well, time's really long. There's actually a lot of original fights before LA even existed. And those we need to honor and bring into current time because it's all a part of where we are today.
And I think I think about the People's EIR as an attempt to definitely challenge some of the erroneous information that exists in the original environmental impact report, such as the fact that there are only 5 coyotes in the whole of the Canyon Hills project site, and also that there's, you know, mountain lions do not exist in the Verdugos. And obviously the California mountain lion is now a candidate species for protection, which affords it some real kind of legal protections under CEQA. But the original environmental impact report just says, nah, there's none here, so we don't have to worry about it. But, you know, I think also it's, like, going back to other modes and, like, vectors of knowledge and knowing and thinking about how, you know, other ways that humans relate to landscape and place through story and memory and myth and being and enactment and all of these other kind of modes of relation. And so how can a document function in a way that kind of can accommodate and can contain some of those multimodal emotions, I suppose. And so, but we're also very interested in it still being an actionable document. And I guess that's where I keep coming back in this conversation is, like, we don't want it to just be, and not to say just an art document, you know, but it still has to, we want it to hold weight in the legislative space. We want it to hold space as we advocate through city council and with our attorneys to get this land.
I have one last question, then we can open up to folks. I would love to hear about your future efforts and your vision for collective action around land and sovereignty in Los Angeles, for those of us who don't have the luck to live in the Verdugos. What kind of challenges, what kind of challenges are important for you but that Angelitos are facing, and how do you see No Canyon Hills efforts extending inward to the city? And how has your relationship to Los Angeles shifted and changed, your understanding of sovereignty, land, and ownership in the city changed because coming out of your project and activism?
That's
the
last big question.
I left it for the end.
yeah, lots to think about there. I mean, I think bridging your last question and this one too, like the PEIR is supposed to kind of show what this can look like and is sort of light showing like what it means to organize in a multifaceted way with a lot of different people doing a lot of different things. And I think that a big thing we're interested in is coalition building. And that's what has been interesting, like a lot of citizen science, you know, like I did this training to do bee surveys, which Xerces Society is really into doing. And that is really cool and important, but it's sort of in its own world. But then you bring that into the PEIR, No Canyon Hills, and then it's like, okay, we're looking at this thing, and then there's someone who is doing, like, a bird survey, and then there's someone who's doing, you know, like, mapping of the waterways, and blah, blah. And so I think, like, yeah, thinking about all the different people who can get involved with something is helpful, because sometimes with, you know, activism and stuff in the city, it can feel really niche, where it's like, oh, you're, like, a housing person. Like, I actually used to do tenants union work, and it was really different from this, because it was really narrow and focused. But it also was a lot harder. Burnout was much more common. And I think this has been amazing because there's so much moving through it and so many different people involved. So we made a map, and that's also ever-expanding, too, of the other similar fights going on in Southern California, in L.A., because it's not just Canyon Hills. There's Elephant Hill. There's Paradise Hill. There's all of these different sites where this is happening. So working with those folks too is really important to us because it is all like the same mission.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, if anyone's interested, we put together this interactive, as Haley mentioned, interactive sort of community mapping project, and you can access it from our website and from the Instagram. And it kind of plots the various organizations, nonprofits, coalitions that are working in housing work, union organizing, land use, stewardship, environmental protection in Los Angeles. And, you know, I think coalition building is something that we want to connect what we're doing to the other folks in our city and try and have change that can be effective systematically across Los Angeles, you know, beyond just this one.
Thank you both. Can we have some, are there any questions from the audience? We have a little bit of time before we wind down.
I'm
starting here, yeah?
I'm just curious why it took so long, like if it was approved in 2005, what's kept it from being built this long?
Yeah, that's a great question. So the developer, when he got, Whitebird Inc. is the developer's name, and when he got his approvals, he received a 20-year development agreement with the city of LA, and they were quite common back then, but what it does is it approves this development for 20 years with all the protections, and it's granddaddied into only the conditions that were necessary back then, so it doesn't have to conform to any updated environmental review or, you know, conditions or anything. And so he had this 20-year timeline in which he was protected. There was the 2008 recession, financial crash, you know, blah blah blah.
And he got in trouble because he didn't have a permit to build in California.
He's
from, like, Texas.
So I think he knew he had 20 years in which no one was going to challenge. manage this, and so he was amassing amassing the appropriate finances. It's an expensive project.
But it expires 2026, so that's the sudden rush where he's been like, maybe we'll start blowing up these mountains and grading, and where we come in.
It's a really great question, thank you, and it's been a big learning curve for us to figure that out. We are trying to be really active and present in lots of different kind of community spaces. So we have like the social media space, right, and even each of those platforms sort of has their own kind of built-in audience or like usership, and then we're also doing like canvassing in different neighborhoods, like in and around Tohunga and Sunland, so that means like in the very beginning, literally hundreds of flyers in people's mailboxes, and you know, every Sunday going out and just flyering literally people's houses, and then going to all of the neighborhood council meetings for the various different neighborhood divisions in and around the area, showing up at those meetings, giving little talks, meeting people and having coffee with them. We have just meeting our neighbors and various different people for like for coffee into hunger and just chat. It's like there's a lot of this work that has to happen in order to get representation from different groups, and it's like it's a lot of work, but it's rewarding when you do get everyone in.
Yeah, I think to add to that too, like No Canyon Hills has been very horizontal just naturally. I mean, Emma and Mateo have, you know, done a ton of the footwork and are sort of leading us, but I think there's just been like a lot of trust with everyone involved, and you can really feel that. Like earlier on, I gave a talk with another No Canyon Hills person, and I was like, "Oh my gosh, do you want to see all my slides and check everything out?" And I was like, "It's cool." And so that trust is really nice, and I think people can really feel that when it's like the community vision night didn't feel like this hierarchy of like we're talking at you. It was like 10 different people talked of all different, you know, expertise or weird little niches they're coming from. And we also had a moment where it was like, hey, talk to the person sitting next to you about what you want for this space and like get to know them. And everyone was able to like talk and meet, which was nice because it had been so online. And then we were able to like open that up and share it. And so I think trying really actively to like fight those hierarchies that can sometimes naturally emerge within any organizing, and just reminding yourself to like break them down and like make it person to person, make it like multifaceted so that a lot of different voices are just on the same level. Yeah.
Any other questions? We still have a little time. Do you have any comments you want to close with?
Thank you so much.
Please come to our space, and we're in the L. We're in the L. See all the work by the amazing folks who have been contributing and working really hard.
Everything's free. It's true. It's really good stuff.
Yeah.
Thank you all for coming.
The mountain.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.